Radio Bielefeld am Abend. Die Hitstory mit Stefan Schüler.
Jo, schönen guten Abend, herzlich willkommen.
Hi, this is Francis Rossi of Status Quo and Radio Bielefeld on Hit Story.
For sure, the number one rock and roll band in the land, 1977, das Live-Album, the one and only Live-Album. Heute gibt es 2 Stunden Status Quo and nothing else but Status Quo. Welcome everybody, herzlich willkommen, schön, dass ihr alle da seid. Ich habe Francis getroffen, Francis Rossi in Hamburg. Sie kamen von Wetten, das waren dann noch in Leipzig und hatten 2 Tage frei in Hamburg. Grund genug für mich hinzufahren und mich mit ihm zusammenzusetzen an der Alster im Hotel. War sehr schön, der Mann war locker drauf, alles easy. Und ich habe ihm eine Menge Fragen gestellt und ich hoffe, dass wir heute davon viel, viel durchkriegen. Mal sehen, was wir an Fragen schaffen, sonst machen wir nächste Woche noch eine Sendung. Ist ja auch egal. Man weiß also, die Bielefelder wissen, die Band ist ja schon öfter hier gewesen, hat auch besondere Erinnerungen an die Stadt, muss man auf jeden Fall sagen. Also so die erste Frage an Francis war natürlich, was haben wir zu erwarten, wenn ihr im Oktober wiederkommt, dann nämlich der 2. Teil der Deutschland-Tournee in diesem Jahr. Im Herbst sind sie in Germany unterwegs und kommen Ende Oktober zu uns. Also what do we have to expect when you come to Bielefeld again, and can you remember the city?
There were some new songs from the new album, and hopefully a normal Status Quo show. I never like to say that it's going to be good, bad, or fantastic, or not fantastic, because that sets up expectations, and I try not to have expectations on anything. I try going to a gig with a zero line, so everything on the gig is a plus. But we have fond memories of Bielefeld. It was where we started in Deutschland, and we used to live in, and kind of, we would come to Deutschland and stay in a hotel, in a cheap hotel in Bielefeld, and we would work out of Bielefeld and come back to Bielefeld every night. And that's where Ulla, Gert and Ulla came from. We knew those two people, Gert, and there was a very handsome man who drove an Alfa Romeo. Damn fool, I would have driven a BMW. And Ulla was a very, very attractive girl. And they were the darlings of Bielefeld. And that's why we had Gert and Ulla.
For sure. Also zum Konzert will er erstmal gar nicht so viel sagen. Man soll nicht so viel erwarten. Dann ist alles, was passiert, ist auf jeden Fall schon mal positiv. Ja, und diese Geschichte von Gert und Ulla, es sollen also die Darlings von Bielefeld gewesen sein. Anfang der 70er ist das gewesen. Die Band hat in Ostwestfalen gespielt. Und irgendwer hat ihnen dieses Lied gegeben. Und sie fanden das klasse. Sie fanden das klasse, ein attraktives Mädchen. Und er fuhr nicht mal BMW, sagt Fred. Yes, BMW. Francis ist bekennender BMW-Fan. Also die Stadt Bielefeld hat einen Platz in der Geschichte der Band mit diesem Song, der da heißt Gerdundula. Und das ist die Rückseite von In My Chair aus dem Jahr 1970.
Love, it seems I just can't find.
Ein einmaliges Erlebnis, Status Quo, Special bei Radio Bielefeld und zu hören übers World Wide Web. Und ich hoffe, es hören ganz, ganz viele Leute zu, an alle, die zuhören. Herzlich willkommen, welcome to the show. Ja, Gerd und Ulla, ein bisschen Bielefelder Geschichte hängt mit dran. Die Band kommt im Herbst wieder auf Tournee. Francis hat gesagt, nicht so viel vorher Erwartungen schüren. Wenn man die neue CD nimmt, Quid Pro Quo, dann sieht man, da sind auch ganz, ganz uralte Sachen drauf. Pictures of Matchstick Man ist da drauf und Ice in the Sun ist da noch drauf. Francis, ihr spielt diese alten Dinger immer noch.
Yeah, those two songs we decided. We'd done Matchstick Man before in probably in the late 80s or early 90s. A band that was from America that was supporting us did it in their encore. And we thought it was a really good idea. When we did it, the following tour, when the song starts, the audience has this, oh. But the further we went into the song, the less the audience seemed to like it. So this time when we did it with Ice in the Sun and Matchstick Men together. And it was a much shorter version of Matchstick Men and slightly more modern. And I would have thought that was a mistake, but it wasn't. For some reason, I said, you open with Matchstick Men, you hear everybody, oh. And the further it went into Matchstick Men, the less they liked it. And yet this time when we did it, it worked perfectly. So as much as I love that song, and it was the first song I wrote that was a big hit.
You wrote it in the bathroom, listening to Jimi Hendrix. What's the story about? Which Jimi Hendrix song is behind that?
Hey Joe.
Hey Joe, yeah. It's behind Matchstick Man.
All those runs were fascinating at the time.
You personally influenced by Jimi Hendrix as a guitar player?
No, not at all.
No?
No. I thought Jimi Hendrix was at the time, I didn't much like it. I liked his singles, but I don't like things that are messy. And certain things I would hear of Jimi Hendrix would be really messy. And Andy Fairweather Lowe from Amen Corner used to go and see him a lot. And he came, and we were talking about him one night, and he said he was his hero. He said, but Jimmy can be either really, really good or complete chase. There was never, well, it was okay. It's either really fantastic or really horrible. And that's what I used to find. I found it really, it was much later in life, I kind of appreciated that he was a good guitar player. And I think we have to be careful when heroes of the 60s or 70s have died. If they had lived, we are terrible, us humans. We go off people. We don't want them to get old, so therefore when they do, we're disappointed. And I think if Jimi Hendrix, I think if Mark Bolan and many others had lived, they would have been ringing the bell. They would have been become sad, I think, because for some reason I find it odd that the world has this thing with age that... As I said, Mark Bolan died young. Everyone said it was very, very sad. And yet, if he'd gotten older, people didn't want to know him because he's old. We're born to grow old. Mm-hmm. If we die in between, it's sad. So I don't understand. Anyway, Jimmy, I copied him. I tried to copy Hey Joe, and I came out with Matchstick Men. So I'm going to take some more Jimi Hendrix things and try and copy them.
Das ist eine gute Idee. Ja, man könnte noch ein paar mehr Jimi Hendrix Songs kopieren. Er hat Pictures of Matchstick Men auf der Toilette geschrieben, weil sein Papa ihn immer genervt hat. Er soll nicht den Papa nerven. Also hat Francis sich aufs Klo gesetzt und hat da ein bisschen rumgefiedelt. Ne? Und er sagt, also Jimi Hendrix konnte große Klasse sein, aber der konnte auch richtig komplett scheiße sein. Also das hat Francis so gesagt. Und ja, er sagt auch, wer weiß, was mit diesen ganzen alten Rockstars heute wäre. Menschen werden alt, logisch. Und möglicherweise wären wir alle enttäuscht über das, was die dann heute machen würden, aber ja, wer weiß, vielleicht sollte er in der Tat nochmal irgendwie einen anderen Jimi Hendrix Song kopieren. Status Quo in der Hitstory bei Radio Bielefeld. Gruß nach Berlin zu Sevi, der ist auch dabei. Wenn ihr dabei seid, schickt doch mal eine Mail rein hier an hitstory@radiobielefeld.de. Würde mich freuen, mal zu hören, wo überall die Quo-Fans heute Abend sitzen. Das hier ist von Quid Pro Quo. Vom Quid Pro Quo. Zwei CDs sind ja drin und das eine ist das Official Live Bootleg aufgenommen im letzten Jahr. Das war Pictures of Ice in the Sun sozusagen. Gleich gibt es etwas ganz Besonderes für alle Quo-Fans. Wir haben 1996, als die Band schon mal in Bielefeld gewesen ist, das erste Stück, was die gespielt haben, mitschneiden dürfen. Achte auf den Sound, das ist super interessant.
Radio Bielefeld.
Golden oldies of the 60s.
Ja, das Intro. Paper Plane 70, 71, ne? Golden oldies of the 60s. Oh, Quatsch. Quatsch. Paper Plane, so hörte sich das damals an in der Stadthalle in Bielefeld. Und im Oktober ist Status Quo wieder in der Stadt. Im Oktober ist Bielefeld in ganz, im Oktober ist Status Quo in ganz Deutschland noch einmal unterwegs. Im Moment haben sie Pause, 2, 3, 4 Tage. Wochenende geht's weiter, ne? Ja. Das war die Zeit hier, als Don't Stop rauskam. Ne? Francis erzählt, fand er eigentlich alles gar nicht so prickelnd da mit diesen ganzen Oldies, die nicht von ihm waren. Ja. Aber manchmal sitzt einem eben auch die Plattenfirma im Nacken und dann muss man irgendwas tun. Hm? Und vermarktet wurde diese Scheibe sensationell und mit den Beach Boys zusammen. Fun, fun, fun. Gab auch ein großes Konzert in Berlin, als man dann zusammen aufgetreten ist. So klang das in Bielefeld 1996 in der Stadthalle. Mit Paper Plane. Pass auf. Der Andreas hat schon geschrieben aus Bayern. 4500 Times von Status Quo, gute Idee, Andreas. Schauen wir mal, was wir schaffen heute, ne? Remember that, Werner?
Riding on a big white butterfly, turn my back away towards the sky. I took my eyes to look for something, saw myself as really nothing, and I realized my butterfly wasn't really up there with me. We all make mistakes, fuck you. Would you like to ride my butterfly? Riding on a long blue paper plane, getting shit-faced, sorry, once again. This trip is getting nearer, hope the fog lens makes it clearer. Then I realize my paper plane wasn't really up there with me. We all make mistakes.
Yeah.
Would you like to ride my paper plane?
Thank you.
Kollegin Julia kommt gerade rein und sagt, jetzt schalten die bestimmt alle ab, wenn jetzt die Nachrichten kommen. Ja. Nachrichten gehören auch zum Geschäft. Radio Bielefeld mit dem Status Quo Special heute Abend. Das war Paper Plane, der erste Song, den Status Quo gespielt hat, als sie 1996 schon mal in Bielefeld gewesen sind, in der Stadthalle. Sie kommen wieder im Oktober. Wir kommen auch gleich wieder mit mehr Musik. Rock'n'Roll in You und Rock'n'Roll the World und Rock'n hier und Rock'n da. Alles kein Problem. Wie gesagt, vorher aber die Kollegin Julia Forsthövel mit den Nachrichten.
Radio Bielefeld am Abend. Die Hit-Story mit Stefan Schüler.
Und mit Status Quo, so ist das. Schönen guten Abend, herzlich willkommen, schön, dass ihr da seid. Welcome everybody to the show. Quid Pro Quo ist ja erfolgreich in die Hitparaden eingestiegen, auf Platz 13 in Deutschland, unglaublich irgendwie, auf Platz 13 in England, auf Platz 10 oder irgendwie sowas, tolle Geschichte. Wir haben Francis Rossi im Interview, ich habe ihn in Hamburg getroffen, 2 Stunden lang, er hat heute frei, vielleicht hört dazu, hello Francis, if you're listening, it was great meeting you. Wir sprechen ein bisschen über die aktuelle CD, diesen Song hier, Rock'n'Roll in You, den konnte man ja runterladen, kann man immer noch runterladen, Francis. Das war so eine Art Single-Auskopplung und die konnte man runterladen irgendwie von it was to download from your page.
It's funny, that song was written by myself and Andrew and was offered up for the fourth Chord album, the last album, and the producer Pitt Williams, because the chorus starts on the third of the chord, da, 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 he said it wasn't very rock and roll, so Andrew and I said okay, fine, you know. And then time goes by and I move house. I've been in one house for 35 years and I moved from, say, there to there in a brand new house. And I had to rebuild the studio. And I built the studio and we're working in the studio. I started working on these old songs and that was one of them. And I called Andrew in one day. I said, look, this is really good. There's something about it. And I said, the whole idea of rock and roll, I hate music that has references to rock and roll, rock you, rock me, rock, drives me mad. And however, this album has more references to rock and roll than any album we've done. And the idea of rock and roll in you, and we were trying to rewrite the lyric a bit. And I said to Andrew, rock and roll in you is all I ever knew. And rock, you know, anybody that's in music has a woman, or it can be referred to me and Rick. Rock and roll in you is all I've ever knew. It's all I want to do, really, is rock and roll in you. And I thought, that's good. And then Andrew with the no fancy pants, no dinner and dance, no Jaguar, no Lardy, hole in shoe, hole in guitar, that's me. And it sort of all fell together, and that's some of the beauty of making music, is when it falls together like that. And that single went out and got more interest and more than we've seen in 20 years. Don't know why. Probably the timing is right. It's good sound, it's well recorded, and we're all very happy with it.
It's in the charts in the UK at 10, in Germany at number 13. Another chart album for the Quo. Did it take you a long time to write the songs? To get the songs together?
No, it was peculiar because we were talking about doing the album, or the manager suggested to us that we needed to do an album. And I produced 7 songs, and Mike Paxman produced the other 7. Mike, we like working with, and I think the others trust Mike more than me, and I understand that. So I did my 7. So I'd done 7 songs ready to go, and then we did the following 7 in, maybe it was February, March, I can't remember. But so we worked on the separate 7 songs. But what is, 2 or 3 things seem to happen on this album. A, I mentioned to the manager, I don't know where to go with the writing. And I said, I wish I was AC/DC, I could just do the same thing. They say that about Quo, but AC/DC are the same. And he said, but that's what your fans would like you to do, another Paper Plane, another Rocky, another whatever you want. And I didn't go in and start trying to write that way, but it took away any barriers. So I just went, that's why there's so many references to rock and roll. And also said to the drummer when he came in the studio, I said, Matthew's a very controlled man and a very controlled mood and very controlled drumming, fantastic drummer. Mm-hmm. I said, Matt, we don't really need you playing Steely Dan meets Quo, which I'm sure he can do. I said, I just need vibe with a few breaks. And he went in there, and his fantastic drive from Matthew on every track, which, again, I must give him all credit for. And I'd said to everybody before that historically what we would do when making an album, if he wrote the song on guitar or piano, say, or maybe guitar, he would come, then Rick or I have to do his part and learn his part. And but that's already it's moved away from the original sponsoring thought. So for argument's sake, anyway you like it, Andrew's. I said, right, Andrew needs to play the core. Mm-hmm. Andrew sat and played guitar with a click. So we got the core, and then the rest of the song was built around the original idea. Well, as I said before, we would take away the original idea and wonder why it didn't sound. And that's what happened on every single track. The original idea is at the middle of it, and everything else goes on around it. So on the other seven tracks, John Edwards played a lot of the core. So there are two rhythm guitars as well as mine. Mm-hmm. And that's the only things I can see make this album different or better. Or everyone seems to think we've gone back to our roots. It's not. I find that very difficult. You're an older man. You know, if someone says, can you go and think like you did when you were 20? No. Mm-hmm. I'm not there anymore. I can try and pretend to think that way, but it's not real. So when I hear people say we've gone back to our roots, I think, sure business. So all we did was try writing, and it worked. Now, if this carries on being successful as it is, I'm going to try and do that again next time, believe me, because I like the album.
It's great graphics.
Beautiful. That was our manager's idea, on the Picasso style. I think that's great. Beautiful. Plus, what I really like is I don't have to have a photograph. You know, we're getting older, and even when we're not older, I still go, oh, I'm so fed up looking at photographs.
Oh, you're looking good. For 62, it's all right.
Yeah, but your optician is, but you need to speak to him.
I'm 57 now.
So baby.
I'm on your way.
Ah, ja, ja, ja. Also die grafischen Arbeiten auf der CD haben wir angesprochen. Diese gezeichneten Männchen, das ist ja wirklich große Klasse. Und Francis Rossi sagt, ja, das hat er auch klasse gefunden irgendwie. Also ne, so ein Foto von ihm irgendwie, so braucht ja keiner von der Band. Die gucken alle schon so alt aus der Wäsche. Das will doch keiner wirklich sehen. Und er sagt also zu Rock'n'Roll and You, ja, ja, das also sie hatten den Song schon eher fertig für das letzte Album schon. Und irgendwie ging das nicht so gut und mit dem Rock'n'Roll, und da kamen sie irgendwie nicht so recht voran. Und dann aber Andy kam dazu, und dann hat es irgendwie doch geklappt, und der Song ist ja sehr beliebt und ist ganz, ganz viel downgeloadet worden, und die Band ist glücklich mit dem Ding. Also Francis Rossi sagt, also zwei, drei Dinge sind passiert so bei der Aufnahme, bei der Entstehung dieser CD, quid pro quo, die aktuelle CD. Erst wusste man nicht, Francis wusste also erst so gar nicht, in welche Richtung sollten jetzt die Songs denn gehen, und dann hat er zu seinem Manager gesagt, weißt du was, ich wünsche, ich wäre so wie AC/DC, weil die machen auch immer irgendwie dasselbe für ihre Fans, sagen die Leute über Status Quo auch. Aber AC/DC, sagt Francis Rossi, die sind ähnlich. Und unser Manager, sagt er, hat dann daraufhin gesagt, ja, dann schreib doch irgendwie ein neues Paperplane oder schreib irgendwie ein neues Whatever You Want oder so. Das wollen doch eure Fans. Ja, und das hat ihm dann die Richtung gegeben. Und dann hat er zu seinem Drummer Matthew gesagt, er soll mal wieder richtig draufhauen. Ja, und die Richtung war da, und dieses ganze Back to the Roots, sagt er, das ist alles irgendwie Quatsch, weil man wird eben älter, und da kann man nicht wieder irgendwas machen, wie wenn man 25 ist. Sie haben die Songs im Heute geschrieben, naja, und wenn die Fans das klasse finden, dann soll es so sein, und dann wird er das nächste Mal nochmal wieder ganz genauso machen. Wir spielen jetzt Rockin' All Over the World, die Hymne von Live Aid, da sprechen wir gleich drüber. 1992 war das hier Live Alive, Quo Rockin' All Over the World. Status Quo in der Hitstory von Radio Bielefeld. Diese Hitstory gibt es jede Woche Donnerstag, könnt ihr hören. Gibt es die geilen Oldies aus den 60ern, aus den 70ern. Man kann sich was wünschen. Und das können also alle Fans, die jetzt draußen uns zuhören und über www, über unser Webradio, die können also gerne nächste Woche wieder einschalten. Dann gibt es schöne Oldies und vielleicht den ein oder anderen Status Quo Musikwunsch. So Sachen, die jetzt schon reinkommen. Deshalb können wir alles heute nicht so wirklich erfüllen. Aber ich gucke mal, dass wir dann nächste Woche da vielleicht den ein oder anderen noch davon schaffen? Ja, 1984, 85 war Live Aid und 84, da war es ja kritisch. Das Ende der Band irgendwie stand so ein bisschen bevor. Alkohol, Drogen, Alan Lancaster wollte weg und ja, sie haben trotzdem weitergemacht. Ich habe Francis gefragt, warum habt ihr denn 1985 weitergemacht? War das irgendwie so die Aussicht auf Live Aid? Hatte Bob Geldof da irgendwie was mit zu tun in the band? In 1984, the band was disunited. And why did you carry on? Was it the chance to play Live Aid?
No, it was nothing to do with that. The reason the band got back together is that someone came to me and said, I must pay for all the albums on the contract. And they said, well, if you do it, and Rick and Alan were going to do Status Quo 2, and the record company said, no, thank you, we will take Francis and Rick. And so I said, okay, I will do it with Rick for two or three albums and see what happens. Mm-hmm. Had nothing to do with Geldof. When Geldof, we saw him in Phonogram, which was our record company in London, and I don't know why we were there, it's very unusual, and we talked about, will you do a gig? We said, no thanks, Bob, thank you, bye-bye. And again, we were there maybe 2 weeks later, and Bob was still in there trying to get interest for people to play Live Aid. Mm-hmm. And we said, well, I don't really want to do it. I don't know. We weren't seeing what was going on the TV. Plus, I'd heard that stuff since I was in junior school, in primary school, that Africa needs to be fed. And so I said, look, Bob, we're not getting on very well together. We won't sound. We're under-rehearsed. And he said, it doesn't matter. Just be there. But he said that to a lot of the older bands, to whip up the interest. And everybody thought Bob was just doing it for his own ends. But I think he did genuinely believe that he was doing something. And he did become yesterday's man with the media. So I thought that was kind of sad. And I found him a bit of an upstart when he was younger. But he felt for that and he did it. My thing was, why didn't big business get involved? Why didn't the oil companies get involved? Why, when you watch your TV at night, you see an ad for petrol? What for? Because you're going to go to that garage, you're going to go to that petrol, I won't put this petrol in my... So I said this to Bob and a few people at the time, and everybody just ignored it. Why didn't we ask Lufthansa, British Airways, the main national airlines, forget the advertising, 3 months, 6 months, and put that in. No. Wasn't going to happen. So whilst I think it was a good idea and the whole feeling behind it was good, I think we could have done a lot more. It just seems that big business thought to itself, these little idiot boys in rock and roll, it will go away in a few weeks. And it did go away. But so to go back to your original thing, the reason we got back together was because people said that I owed money to the record company for the two or three albums on the contract. Mm-hmm. And so I went and made in the army with Rick. Nothing to do with Bob.
At the end, you did it, the Live Aid concert?
Yeah.
Yeah, you can say it was a good decision for you at least.
I think it was a good decision, but only when we saw the cameras. I didn't know I did. It's a gig. And I've always had this problem that people are always talking, always ask us or me, we were doing Glastonbury 2 years ago, this big festival in England. Are you doing something special for Glastonbury? That's something just fell off the table.
Oh, man.
No, we're not doing anything special for Glastonbury. It's a gig. Each gig is a gig. Each one to me is as important as the last one. I don't care if it's 500 people or 50,000 people. It's just as important. I don't believe in, I'm going to be really special tonight, because A, I don't know if I'm going to be special tonight, and I'm definitely not going to try and be special because somebody else thinks their festival is very important, or whether it's Rock and Ring is important. I don't go, and that's bullshit to me. Every gig is important. There are no special gigs, not even Live Aid. The only thing about Live Aid is when you walked on, the people were ecstatic because they felt like they were doing something. It wasn't the normal, I bought a ticket and we play. They were all just so happy, which is sin. As I said, again, we should have got big business involved. Oil companies, airlines, all the things that are written off for tax. Fine, just for 6 months, put that in the pot. But nobody did. And I get annoyed and I get angry. Shall we change the subject?
Yes,
now?
Of course we can. Also mit Bob Geldof hatte das alles überhaupt gar nichts zu tun, sagt Francis Rossi von Status Quo. Es mussten schlicht Schallplatten rangeschafft werden für die Plattenfirma, sonst hätte er alle den Vertrag bezahlen müssen. Da war er nicht so scharf drauf. Und Bob Geldof sagt Francis, ja, der hat eine Menge Bands zusammengebracht für die gute Sache. Status Quo, ja, hatten also erst nicht wirklich große Ambitionen, haben dann aber trotzdem mitgemacht. Aber, sagt er, was man damals schon hätte machen sollen, 1985, man hätte die großen Unternehmen, Lufthansa, Ölfirmen und so weiter, die hätte man akquirieren sollen, weil die haben wirklich Kohle. Ja, und das hätte man für diese Aktion toll gebrauchen können. Ansonsten ist das für ihn kein besonderes Konzert gewesen. Ein Gig ist ein Gig, sagt er. Jedes Konzert ist gleich wichtig, egal ob da 50 Leute sind oder 50.000. Und das einzig Besondere im Wembley-Stadion, sagt er, das waren die Besucher. Weil ja, die haben also nicht wirklich nur ein Ticket gekauft, die wollten gemeinsam was erreichen. Überschrift war ja Feed the World. Wir sind hier mittendrin im Status Quo Special bei Radio Bielefeld, machen natürlich gleich weiter, klären, was haben die Everly Brothers mit Status Quo zu tun, und ich habe Francis ein Quiz gemacht. Ich habe versucht rauszufinden, ob er denn seine eigenen Songs wiedererkennt. Das wird gleich spannend, wenn ihr uns zuhört, irgendwo, so wie Christian Krischi in Linz in Österreich, dann schickt doch mal eine Mail rein an hitstory@radiobielefeld.de. Gucken wir mal, wer sich da alle so meldet. Und wir machen jetzt kurz Nachrichten und dann sind wir gleich wieder da mit dem Status Quo Special bei Radio Bielefeld.
Radio Bielefeld am Abend. Die Hit Story mit Stefan Schüler.
So ist das und wir machen weiter. Eine Stunde noch. Francis Rossi von Status Quo. Ich habe ihn getroffen vor 4 Wochen in Hamburg und habe mich mit ihm zusammengesetzt und ein bisschen gequatscht über dies und das und jenes. In dieser Stunde erleben wir ein kleines Francis Rossi Status Quo Quiz und wir werden mal gucken, was die Status Quo mit den Everly Brothers zu tun hat. Und wir reden über die Entstehungsgeschichte dieses Songs hier. Pass mal auf. Francis? Hallo?
Hi, this is Francis Rossi of Status Quo, and you're listening to Radio Bielefeld with Stefan, who is such a fabulous man, but like me, he's getting older.
Ja, sehr lustig. Ich habe gelacht, ja. Bleibt uns nicht verschont, ne? Wir bleiben nicht verschont. 1975. Down, down. Status Quo, Down, Down, ihre erste und bisher einzige Nummer 1. Und wie das Ding entstanden ist, da werden wir gleich mal ein bisschen drüber sprechen mit Francis Rossi von Status Quo, der heute exklusiv hier bei Radio Bielefeld Rede und Antwort steht. Ich muss mal gerade hier so ein paar Sachen klären. Ich habe ja eben schon gesagt, dass der Christian, ne? Ja, Krischi hat geschrieben aus Linz in Österreich. Hey ho, bin 29, seit 94 Quo-Fan. Das wird auch immer so bleiben. Toller Sender, super Aufmachung der Sendung über Quo. Auch sonst ist das Radio echt toll. Werde bestimmt öfter mal reinhören. Das tät uns freuen. Das könnt ihr machen. Jetzt kommt hier die Legende gerade rein. Gerade kommt die Legende rein. Stefan Quo. Super Sendung. Vor allem das Interview mit Francis. Ich war auch in Hamburg Stadtpark dabei. War zu nass, sagt er. Ich bin seit 73 Quo-Fan. Meine Website ist auf der offiziellen Quo-Seite verlinkt und ich habe schon mit der Band gefrühstückt. Ich habe ein Quo-Tattoo mit Autogramm eintätowiert von Rick und Francis. Ja, könnt ihr gucken. Stefan Quo, da könnt ihr das sehen. Wohnt nicht weit von hier in Löhne. Ne? Arminia-Fan ist er auch noch. Also bitteschön, mehr geht nicht. Nochmals Glückwunsch zu der tollen Sendung. Stefan Quo, ey, geil. Ja, wir haben ja, ich muss ja sagen an dieser Stelle, wir haben ja für diese Sendung Werbung gemacht. Und wir waren sind auf diversen Fanpages gelandet. Im Quo-Ticker sind wir gelandet. Die haben das also geschrieben. Statusquorockt.de, da haben wir das geschrieben. Da stand es geschrieben, dass diese Sendung stattfindet. Und auf der offiziellen Homepage von Status Quo stand, dass diese Sendung heute, steht immer noch, dass diese Sendung heute Abend stattfindet. Dafür herzlichen Dank. nach England an Mike Paxman. Der hat das klar gemacht da, der passt auf die Seite auf. Grüße auch an Andrea hier aus Bielefeld, die das Konzert betreuen wird, wenn Status Quo Ende Oktober nach Bielefeld kommt. Ja, in die Stadthalle kann man Karten kaufen. Thomas aus Augsburg hat kräftig mitgeholfen. Danke dafür nochmal, Thomas, dass das Konzert überhaupt stattgefunden hat. Und was habe ich hier noch? Friedrich Wilhelm hat auch geschrieben, der Mann ist zurzeit in, wo treibt er sich rum? In Vilnius, also irgendwie im Osten, ja. Auch alter Quofeld, alter Bielefelder auch, ne? Ja, und also wenn ihr zuhört und wenn ihr mögt, dann schickt eine Mail mal an hitstory@radiobielefeld.de, damit ich weiß, wer so alles dabei ist. Es gibt ein neues Buch von Status Quo. Ab September soll das rauskommen, die Status Quo Autobiografie. Das ist so neu eigentlich nicht, weil das gibt es schon auf Englisch. Jetzt wird es das auf Deutsch geben. Ich habe es mir alles reingezogen, was da drin steht. Viele, viele Geschichten. Und in einer davon, da geht es um die Entstehung von Songs, wie also Status Quo das auf die Reihe kriegt mit Songs. Und im Speziellen geht es um dieses Down Down.
Yes, well the point is the song we started, I started the back, the chord sequence in, not really a sequence, but the chord thing in Los Angeles. Mm-hmm. And then we got back to England and Bob was at my house and we did the first verse, lovely. And again, and again, and again, and no, let's do the second verse. Second verse, lovely. Again, and let's do the third verse. So we do the third verse, and then we sat there that night, and I said, no, we have to come back. So he came back the following night. And I said, you remember, I said, Mark Boland, we were talking about Mark Boland. He had and that's something about writing rock pop songs. It's not necessarily the lyrical content as opposed to the shape of the word that sits with the melody. Again, duh. There it was, down. I said, it makes no sense. Makes no sense at all. Down, deeper. And so we talked between us saying, well, perhaps it means sense of down, go away. Go away, kind of, you know. And it worked, and the whole song, and the children loved it. And I thought that was bad at the time, but if a three-year-old, usually they have something, and you'll find that there's something they have, little ones. And then many years later, you know, in the last 15 or 20 years, we're doing the show down, all the women are going, No, okay, never thought of that. At the time, that was not a thought. These days, all the women are,
Yeah.
It's great on radio, that, isn't it?
Yeah, it's great on radio. Macht er schöne Gesten hier, macht er im Radio. Das ist unglaublich. Francis Rossi, ey. Ja, er sagt, also irgendwie kamen sie nicht richtig voran mit diesem Down-Down-Ding. Irgendwie hatten sie auch keinen Plan, wie das heißen sollte. Irgendwie waren sie am Schrammeln und am Schrummeln. Und dann kam irgendwann Bob Young dazu. Und dann kam diese Idee mit T-Rex. Und T-Rex hatte mal einen Song, der hieß Deborah. Und da war dieses Duff. Und das war's dann. Und dann wurde Down-Down fertig geschrieben. Der Text macht irgendwie zwar keinen Sinn, sagt Francis. Aber die Kinder, die fanden das Lied klasse. Und Kinder können an der Stelle ja nicht irren. Ne? Das war kein Frauentext, hat nichts zu tun mit Down Down und irgendwie so Nummer 1 in England 1975. Und wie gesagt, das Buch kommt im September in deutscher Sprache auf den Markt. Witzig wird das jetzt. Ich habe mit Francis ein kleines Quiz gemacht, habe ich vorbereitet, habe ihm so seine eigenen Lieder in ganz kurz mal vorgespielt und Francis musste raten. Und ja, wie das ausgegangen ist und das hören wir jetzt. Die entscheidende Frage an Francis war diese.
Can you recognize your own songs?
Yeah.
I hope so. Okay, we try it.
Go on then. Let's stop. April, Spring, Summer and Wednesdays.
Ooh. From 1907.
27.
Something like that. Yeah, okay, take
That's
the next
nice, one. Nice, that front. Nice intro.
Take the next one. All right,
stop. Is that Baby Boy?
Yeah, great. 77.
Yeah, well, I'm going to look at remixes.
He knows them all.
That's that Christmas song.
A Status Quo Christmas song.
Yeah, not my idea. Not my thing.
But you played guitar on it. Yeah.
Well, yeah, I mean, it's Rick. I have to. Rick really thinks it was going to make a difference, and he always wants the idea of this Christmas song. I would never have gone in a Christmas song with Quo. Dum-de-dum-de-dum. I would never have done that. I'd have tried to go somewhere else. But
I think it's great.
I know. People love it.
Every time Wham and Slade and Gary Glitter and things. Now we have a Quo Christmas song.
Yeah, well, maybe. It will go. In time, it will become a Goldie, yeah.
Next one.
It's people all around, they look at Little Miss Nothing.
Little Miss Nothing, yeah. Flip side of Ice in the Sun.
Are you growing tired of my love? No.
No.
Oh, I make me stay a bit longer.
Yeah.
No.
And is that recent? Yeah, that's mad about the boy.
Yeah, mad about the boy. 1 point. 1 point more. We have five. Only two.
You could do this all day. I'll be. Stop.
What happened there?
Your shit hot stuff. He says, your shit hot stuff. And then Rick says, looks like the back of a pinot tree. There's a guy that we had work for us. He had such a hairy back. Rick could see him from the glass at the control room. And I was talking to him. We'd had a take, do another take. And I was talking to Adam Lancaster, sat in a room. And he said something. And it's an expression in England where they say you're shite hot stuff. Because it's that hot, you can't touch it. You won't touch it. And that's when he said and went into that. And then Rick said, looks like the back of a kinoak tree. So they push out the swear word. In a nowhere, and I lost her.
This shit hot stuff, ain't it?
I didn't. I like that song.
Weird. Great song. Great song. One of my favorites.
Yeah,
last
I love
one.
It.
Last one.
Is that an ant? Wait a minute. Wait a minute. Don't be big. No, you haven't. Wait a minute. Wait a minute. It's Andrew Bowne and myself wrote this, no? I don't.
No, you don't wrote this. You don't wrote that.
Oh, got him. Yes.
It's not one of yours. It's When I'm Dead and Gone.
Oh, is it?
Yeah.
That's not fair. It's a cover. I don't
think that. Yeah, it's a cover. You did a lot of covers.
Scheisse.
Yeah, scheisse cover. Don't like that. Don't like covers. You don't do any cover CDs.
No, to be honest, when you want to do the odd song, it's great. But when we were first presented with the idea of doing Don't Stop, I sat depressed for about 3 months thinking that, well, there's no point in... And I realised then, even though I think status quo songs, you know, what people talk about them, they're not real songs, it's still, in my little life, something for me to be able to write a song. And to not to have to write a song at that point, I was almost, well, what's the point? I had no point in being in a band. I don't wish to go out on tour doing loads of covers. I enjoy...
Also eins müssen wir aufklären, Little Miss Nothing ist die Flipseite, damals die Singles hatten noch eine Rückseite, liebe Kinder, von Price of Love, das Weihnachtslied, sagt er, das ist irgendwie nicht sein Ding, Rick Parfitt wollte immer gerne ein Weihnachtslied machen, ich finde das gut, das Weihnachtslied, habe ich ja auch gesagt, und diese Geschichte da bei What to Do 1975, das war irgendwie so eine völlig krude Geschichte im Studio, da lief eben so ein Typ rum, der hatte ganz viele Haare auf dem Rücken, und da haben sie sich irgendwie wohl drüber kaputt gelacht. Und Covers, CDs, sagt er, ich habe es ja vorhin auch schon mal selber gesagt, bei Don't Stop war das so, bei einigen anderen CDs. Er hat das also nie so wirklich geliebt, diese ganzen Covergeschichten zu spielen. Francis spielt logischerweise lieber Quo-Songs als Lieder von anderen Leuten. Ausnahmen bestehen gegen die Regel. 1975 ist das nicht so gewesen. Wir hören uns das mal komplett an, das Ding. What to do? 1975.
Status quo. Wow.
Sheriff's coming.
We're going for it now.
Looks like a fig tree from the back.
Yeah, we're going for it.
Only missed.
Status Quo im Interview bei Radio Bielefeld, um genau zu sein, Francis Rossi, What to Do, 1975 ist das gewesen. Wir haben natürlich auch mal so ein paar private Sachen irgendwie geklärt. Sein Vater, der ist ja ein Eismann gewesen, also der hat der Eiscreme verkauft und Francis hatte also als kleines Kind immer lecker Eis und der Papa, der war unterwegs mit einem kleinen Auto, ne, hatte ein kleines Eiscreme und der hatte das schon geerbt sozusagen, weil auch der Opa von Francis, der hat schon Eis verkauft. Also die logische Frage, was mag denn Francis so für Eis? What is your favorite gelati, Senor Rossi?
Vanilla.
Vanilla, simply vanilla.
My grandfather used to make the ice cream. And John Edwards, the bass player, we were somewhere the other week. John Edwards, the bass player, went out and he went to an ice cream place where they taught them all about ice cream, how it used to be made. And so I told him how it used to be made by my grandfather. He was kind of fascinated by it all. But I just grew up, and that was what my grandfather did. And they had this small factory. At the front was the kind of cafe, restaurant. At the back was the for make the ice cream. And that's what we all grew up doing. We grew up in that kind of retail environment. So if I hadn't sold BMWs, it would be... someone's having a shave. If I hadn't sold BMWs, I would have sold ice cream. So I would be happy selling BMWs. I didn't want to sell ice cream.
Ja, gut. Also Francis würde lieber BMWs verkaufen als Ice Cream, wenn gar nichts mehr geht. Weil er ist ja gestandener BMW-Fan und da steht er ja zu. Und das soll er meinetwegen dann auch sein. Ne? Das hier kommt aus dem Jahr 1961 von den Shadows. FBI, was Francis Rossi davon hält, von Status Quo. Das werden wir gleich hören hier bei Radio Bielefeld. Die Shadows. Da war Francis Rossi also 49 geboren, da war der 12, ne? 12 Jahre alt. Da hat Francis Rossi schon die Shadows gehört. FBI, die ja dann auch unter anderem die Begleitband waren von Cliff Richards. Und da kann man Francis natürlich mal ganz was Einfaches fragen. What do you think when you hear this, when you hear the Shadows?
Take me back to when I was younger. They weren't wild or anything like that. They were just this fantastic sound. And that's the whole thing with music, rock music, pop music, show business, is that the person listening or watching, it's what they imagine it to be, is what it is. The truth about show business, rock and roll, we don't want to see its bum. Do you know what I mean? You don't want to go around and see the hinton, is it? They don't want to see behind. You have to see the... isn't it fantastic? And that's what we have to keep going. And that's what I remember. It's before I knew what show business was like. And I don't mean that in a bad way. It was just magical. And there were mono records and there were... there was just something about FBI. And the idea, particularly in England when I was a boy...
Well, 61. FBI was in 61.
To call a song FBI was like, wow. Yeah, FBI. I just... And they were instrumentals. They were quite unique, the Stones, Shadows. And I still have their Greatest Hits albums, and I still play them. I just think they're unique.
And who had the idea to do it again? You do the same song with Brian May.
With Brian, yeah. We were doing Don't Stop Al, which is a covers album, which I don't like doing. And we asked Brian to do some stuff, which was fine. He said, well, if I do this for you, will you come and do FBI? And we did it in my studio in my old house, and Brian came to my house, and we did the stuff in FBI, and it just went, it's just stuff that you do. It's, it's perhaps not as important or as monumental as some people think. I'll do that. It's like he says to you, will you come to my house Saturday and help? Yeah, fine. And that's what Brian said, will you play? Yeah, certainly, yeah. Will you? Yeah. But then the managers and PR get involved, and then it becomes business, which is fine. I spoke to Jeff Lynne, who's a friend of mine. I've always liked Jeff Lynne I've known him since I was about 16, I think, 16 or 17. And I talked to him once and I said, would you consider co-producing with me a Francis Rossi album or maybe a choir album? He said, you have to speak to my manager. And I realised then that it's a thing we have to do, even though we're friends. Once we start talking business, we aren't friends anymore. We're talking business. And so he steps back and I step back and the business takes over. And for many years, I thought that was kind of... I was probably a bit more fairy tale thinking it was all lovely. But no, you have to step back and business has to get involved. So that's what happened with Brian, with his manager and our managers.
Johnson Fogerty.
Yes.
Yeah, had a lot of problems with record companies.
He has a lot of problems. We were doing the Montreux Jazz Festival and he was on. And the idea is that we would go and sing something together. We would do Rocking All Over the World together. And he didn't want to do it and he wouldn't near anybody. He was an extremely difficult man. And I felt like that. You see, and that's, you think, oh, well. And that's, you learn to move on. You know, again, it's me being a little bit fairy tale from before I was successful. How fabulous. No, not everybody's fabulous. It's music and image. And the truth, the public don't need to know the truth. It's show business.
But he gets money every week.
Yes.
From that Rocking All Over the World thing, isn't it?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. Well, in fact, there was a story backstage that our PA, the Chinese lady, was stood and somebody looking after him. And just before we were finishing or something, he said to her, you know, I work for the guy that wrote this song. And she said, I work for the band that created all the money for this song. Which is true. We must have earned him so much money on that song, which I don't begrudge that. It's just that it's odd that the guy didn't even come and say hi, thanks, you know, something.
Showbusiness, alles Showbusiness. Und die Menschen müssen nicht immer zwingend die Wahrheit wissen, sagt Francis Rossi von Status Quo. Und die alten Shadows-Zeiten, sagt er, das war geil. Die waren also nicht wild, aber die hatten einen tollen Sound. Und sie haben einen Song FBI genannt. Das fand Francis Rossi großartig. Er hatte ihre Greatest-Hits-Alben zu Hause, hört sie sich immer mal wieder gerne an und hat dann später mit Brian May diesen Song nochmal aufgenommen auf einer Tribute-Scheibe für Hank Marvin. Ja, und obwohl es Probleme gab, wir wollten das so gerne als Freunde zusammen machen, na, mit Brian May. Mit Jeff Lynne wollte er gerne was zusammen machen von Electric Light Orchestra. Als Freunde ging aber nicht, weil jeder hat ein Management und Verträge. Es ging nicht. Ja. John C. Fogerty haben wir angesprochen. Der hatte ja auch eine Menge Probleme mit Plattenfirma und Management und so weiter und so weiter. Sagt der John C. Fogerty, ja, der hat dieses Ding geschrieben, Rockin' All Over the World. Ist ja wunderbar. Wir wollten in Montreux mit ihm zusammen auf der Bühne. Nö, wollte er nicht. Ne? Und tja, so ist es passiert. Cliff Richard, habe ich eben gesagt, die Shadows, Begleitband von Cliff Richard. Cliff Richard hat das ja mal gemacht. Cliff Richard hat ja mal einen Song oder mehrere Songs auf Deutsch gesungen. Die Beatles haben das auch getan. Status Quo hat das nicht gemacht. Macht, stellt sich die Frage, warum nicht, Francis? You never did a song in German language. Why?
There was a period very early on when that was the thing to do, and I was asked possibly to do one in Spanish for Ice in the Sun, and there was talk of doing something, Matchstick Men, I think, in Deutsch. But we were kind of a new school at that time, and we were, oh, we're not doing that kind of thing. And I do think that the rock and roll that we all become, that we so-called know and love, is American. The English want to say it's theirs, or Deutsch might perhaps, but I sing in an American accent, and I talk in an English one. I know German guys that sing a perfect American accent. So the idea of doing it in, it's almost like if I sang in English for the English market, it would sound silly. We've all accepted the fact that these people, whatever they speak, French, Deutsch, Spanish, sing in American. How do we do that? So if I sang in English with an English accent, it would sound really wrong. And so I don't think that was for us. I didn't really want to do that. That felt like old school at the time. We felt we were new and we're not doing that, you know. I don't know now, but...
What about an unplugged album?
No, I hate it. It was one of those things that became very, very fashionable for 10 or 20 minutes and everybody gets on it, so it's no longer special. It's very similar to how people having their own websites and having their own MySpace and Facebook. And it so quickly these days becomes, everyone's got it. It goes from unique to, everyone's got one. And I find that's the same with the unplugged. I don't really want to do unplugged much. No, maybe I'm thinking about it now. I might have changed my mind. Like, yeah, why did you do that?
Like scouts do with a guitar.
When I first started, I wanted to do the Everly Brothers. So that meant jingy, 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 jing, and sing. I was quite happy to do that. I don't have a very good voice. And I decided I learned to play lead guitar. Not very well, but I decided. So people expect me to do acoustic, and there'll be lead guitar to do. I don't want to do that in acoustic. It's different. I don't mind singing jingy, jingy, jing, and I like it. I don't mind that, but it's not going to happen, I don't think.
Jingy, jingy, ja, sagt Francis Rossi, es gab mal eine Zeit, wir sollten mal Pictures of Magic Man auf Spanisch machen, aber nö, das sagt er, das war nicht modern damals, also er fand das alles nicht so gut, jeder sollte in seiner Sprache singen und Rock'n'Roll auf Deutsch und nee, also man kann ja nicht mal wirklich Englisch singen, für den englischen Markt, sagt er, weil die singen alle das amerikanische Englisch, ganz interessant, muss man mal ein bisschen zuhören und Unplugged, Status Quo Unplugged, nee, das will er auch nicht, Unplugged war mal modern irgendwie für 10, 20 Minuten, wie Facebook und irgendwie weiß ich auch nicht was und nee, also so singen wie die Pfadfinder, so Jingy Jingy irgendwie. Obwohl, die Everly Brothers, das war immer toll. Das wollte er auch. Aber nicht unplugged. Nö, die Everly Brothers. Ja, achte drauf. 1965 ist das gewesen, die Everly Brothers. Und wie gesagt, das fand Francis Rossi klasse.
The Everly Brothers were always, that was the first thing I saw that I really, really wanted to do. That was it for me. That was totally it. And when they started to move more modern, getting to Price of Love, when I first heard The Price of Love, I just, as I said, anything the Everlys. So it was a danger because there was a lot of us. I know Robert Plant still. Robert Plant did two songs I always wanted to do on his big album with, what's that lady he sang with?
Mm.
Anyway, he did two tracks. So he did Come On and Stick With Me, Baby, and Please Leave the Letter That I Wrote. I like that too. The Everly Brothers at that point, they da da dum dum do 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 do, that started to lean towards where all Quo can do that because of the riffiness of it. And we've done various versions. We first heard a band do it in 1968. Rick and I were out called the Speakeasy in London. I never went to places like that. Why I was there, I don't know. And there was a band called Heir Apparent, which is E-I-R-R. They're playing the words of H-E-I-R to inherit. They were Irish. And Davey O'List, I think, was in the band and all that. And they did a version of Price of Love, and we thought we have to do that. And we did.
Ah, und dann hat Status Quo gemacht, 4 Jahre später. Und so hat es dann geklungen, Price of Love. Und hat eingeläutet die neue Ära, diese Boogie-Ära mit Bob Young an der Mundharmonika. Ne? Achtung, Price of Love, Status Quo.
Wine is sweet, but you gotta break.
1969, Status Quo, The Price of Love mit Bob Young an der Mundharmonika. Grüße zurück an, wo kommt es denn her hier? Jörg Schäfer hat geschrieben aus Regis in Breitingen, Musikwunsch Soft to Ride. Machen wir vielleicht mal in der nächsten Sendung die Hit-Story, die, was ihr jetzt alle hört. Das kann man jede Woche hören bei Radio Bielefeld. An jedem Donnerstag ist das von 19 bis 21 Uhr. Gibt es schöne alte Oldies, 60er, 70er, 80er, wenn ihr wollt. Und Grüße an Nidi, schreibt Jörg Schäfer. Ich muss auf jeden Fall mich noch bedanken bei Michael, ja, bei Michael Schiller und bei Jürgen Adametz, die ja mit ihren beiden Seiten statusrockt.de und quoticker.de kräftig dazu beigetragen haben, dass wir heute diese Sendung mit vielen Hörern machen. Und als Belohnung verlose ich unter allen, die mir jetzt in den nächsten 10 Tagen eine E-Mail schreiben, verlose ich 2x2 Karten für Status Quo in Bielefeld und ich verlose 2x Quid Pro Quo mit Originalunterschrift von Francis Rossi. Bitte sehr, eine E-Mail an hitstory@radiobielefeld.de. Dann könnt ihr das gewinnen. 2x2 Karten für das Konzert in Bielefeld Ende Oktober und 2x2 CDs. Quid pro quo mit Original Autogramm von Francis Rossi könnt ihr gewinnen. Schickt eine Mail an hitstory@radiobielefeld.de. Ihr seid dabei und die Auslosung, die kommt dann. Francis Rossi ist, weiß ich nicht, ob wer das kennt von euch. Francis Rossi ist ein Chairman of a whiskey, a 200 years old whiskey. Also er ist so diese Galionsfigur. Glen Rossi Whiskey heißt das Zeug. Francis, was ist das denn für eine Geschichte?
That's funny. Some time back, one of the catering people, wherever we go, there's a rider, you know. One of the caterers, we were in Scotland, and I saw this somebody like Glen Rossi. I thought, wait, what you done? It was on the bus. It's one day. I said, what? I get to the bus and it's a bottle of whiskey and it's got my name on it. I'm thinking, it's a joke. It must be a joke. The idea of Glen Rossi. Glen is very, is the whole Scottish thing. And Rossi's very, very Italian. It doesn't make sense how the two came together. And I think possibly, I'd seen this. I thought it was funny. Have a little sip. Yeah. And possibly about 3 years later, I get a letter at my house to do with Status Quo business, which is very rare. So it makes me very suspicious. This letter comes through, you know, and I'm reading this letter.
Ja. Also hat er ist er ein Chairman für einen Whisky ist er geworden. Hat gedacht, die wollen ihn veräppeln irgendwie, aber er hat den hat das also dann gemacht. Kann man gucken, Glen Rossi Whisky, nicht schlecht die Geschichte. Ich habe mit ihm gesprochen auch über die Night of the Proms. Da hat Status Quo gespielt und zwar mit einem riesengroßen Orchester. waren die da zugange. Das war also auch für Status Quo mal irgendwie ganz was Besonderes. Francis, you played Night of the Proms with a huge orchestra.
Yeah, I don't think the recordings are very good. And our engineer that did this album, and that's Greg Jackman, he designed these special little microphones that can go inside even a Stradivarius without marking it. And so you could have 60 violins and have control over every single violin. When we did those shows, they were that worried about using mics at a distance. The amount of overspill from the drums or from the amps that go in those mics that go near the strings. So it affected the recording and affected the balance you end up with. It's very, very difficult to make that work. Whereas if that was done again now we know how to do it. And technology has come forward and we have the microphones to record everything in its own space. But I understand that it's the greatest thing about that is we toured with an orchestra and a choir. It was the biggest tour I'd ever been on before. It was huge. It was fantastic.
You had to play three songs or something like that.
Yeah, that's the worst part. Most of the time all the time. But you get used to it. It's a terrible complaint. I'm sure lots of people would love to think they do nothing most of the day and have to work 2 hours, but. As I said to you, that you know because you make radio, the focus in your head about that 2 hours you have to do is not as easy as people think, and I think that makes a performer is that you know, I've got to do this, I don't want to do this, and then when I don't do it, they say you don't have to do it. I go, what do you mean I don't have to do it? Yeah. I want to do it. There have been many times Rick and I are both like this. We'll be in a gig. And there may be a problem. I think that today's gig may be cancelled. Yes, it's been cancelled. And then we go, and in 45 minutes away from the gig, you think, I would love to have played tonight. So that's that human condition all the time. The grass is always greener over there.
Yeah.
It's always better over there. And the trouble is, it's over there again, isn't it? Yeah.
Yeah. Ja, sagt er, das war was Besonderes, Night of the Proms. Kompliziert war das irgendwie, das Konzert aufzunehmen mit irgendwie jede Violine hatte ein Mikrofon und so. Aber sie haben es hinterher geschafft, er ist von den Aufnahmen nicht so ganz überzeugt, aber anyway, das Blöde, sagt er, bei solchen Konzerten ist ja, wenn da spielst du nur drei Lieder und die meiste Zeit sitzt du rum. Er findet das überhaupt gar nicht lustig. Er sagt, manche Leute denken ja, oh, nur 2 Stunden arbeiten am Tag, das ist ja eine coole Sache. Ja. Aber Francis sagt, du hast den ganzen Tag den Fokus auf diese 2 Stunden und das ist nämlich gar nicht so leicht, wie die Leute immer meinen. Ne? Du musst dich dann nämlich irgendwie total drauf konzentrieren. Night of the Proms 1999, Status Quo with a big, huge, massive orchestra with 60 violins and things, whatever you want. Status Quo at the Night of the Proms 1999 with the big orchestra. Yes, sir. Status Quo Special schon wieder vorbei. Gruß aus Thüringen von Frank aus Sonneberg hat geschrieben. Bernd Holzmann aus Freudenberg hat geschrieben. Klasse Sendung, vielen Dank. Ein Interview, das in die üblichen 0815 Fragen hinausging. Kompliment, let's rock. Schreibt Günther Röder, hallo, coole Sendung, Grüße aus Karlsruhe und ja, so eine CD, die will ich wohl nehmen, sagt er. Kein Ding, also wer eine CD gewinnen möchte von Francis Rossi signiert, der sollte mir schreiben an hitstory@radiobielefeld.de. Ihr müsst natürlich eure Adresse mit draufschreiben, damit wir die Dinger dann auch euch zukommen lassen können. Die Status Quo Special ist zu Ende. We have come to the end. Wie wär's, Francis Rossi? What do you think mit The Party Ain't Over Yet as the last song?
The thing with that song and the writer John David, he used to be in Rock Party. In, what were they called? What was, Dave Edmonds' first band? Love Sculpture. He was in Love Sculpture. Really nice man. I've known him for many, many years. He's really nice. And he's written one or two hits for us. And every time he sends us a demo, we listen to it and think, yes, we've got to do it. It's fantastic. And then we do it. And it's not until it's finished that you go, It's okay. And that's what I find with that. I loved it. The party ain't over yet. It's perfect. But I don't think our version is as good as his demo. And I said this to him recently, and subsequently we aren't doing many of his songs. Now, maybe, as I said to you about the latest album, we should bring John David in and say, John, sit and play the core part, and then we'll build it from there. But what we tried to do is copy his demo, and nope, I don't think it's very good.
A better idea for the last song of our little radio Bielefeld
show? No, it's a
great idea,
because the party ain't over yet. We still continue.
So soll es sein, die Party geht weiter. Ich sage Dankeschön fürs Zuhören all over the world. Thank you, Francis, for putting us on your official Status Quo homepage. It's a great honor for us, for our little radio station, Radio Bielefeld. Thank you, everybody, for listening in the whole wild web world. And I always say bye-bye and rock till you drop. Thank you for listening. Says Stefan from Radio Bielefeld.
There's a trouble wind blowing through my crazy life. I feel the chill begin.